The Science of Magic with Gwilda Wiyaka is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Gwilda Wiyaka's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the Science of Magic or endorsed in any manner by Gwilda Wiyaka, rel-mar McConnell Media Company, its affiliated networks, stations, or employees. Welcome to The Science of Magic with Gwilda Wiyaka, a program dedicated to uncovering the unified nature of reality and humanity's ever-evolving place as truly galactic beings. For more information on The Science of Magic with Gwilda Wiyaka, visit us online at www.thescienceofmagic.net.
Hi there, and welcome once again to The Science of Magic. Gwilda Wiyaka here, bringing yet more dynamic guests and topics to help us enter a deeper understanding of life and our place in it. This hour, we'll pursue our interconnectedness as we consider continuity. We've been living in an age supporting separation, polarization, and tunnel vision. Be it right or wrong, true or false, logical or emotional, scientific or magical, everything has been viewed as mutually exclusive. Many sources indicate we're now entering a time that supports unity and multidimensionality, a time of continuity, whereby polarized approaches are becoming increasingly dysfunctional. We're being challenged to find where things meet and agree in order to embrace a larger truth for wisdom to evolve. How can this be achieved? There's one element that binds all things together, love. Yet we understand so little of love. Love is not an emotion, though we have an emotional response to it. To the quantum physicist, love is scalar energy. To the mystic, the very breath of God. To the philosopher, it's the essence that fills the space between all things. Unity and continuity is complex and can only be understood from a multidimensional, multidisciplinary viewpoint, one which embraces both science and magic. Our guest this hour appears to be well qualified to help us delve into this concept. With us is Forrest Landry, a philosopher, writer, researcher, scientist, software developer, engineer, and craftsman. He's the founder of and CEO of Magic Flight, a B2C wood products design and manufacturing company. Skilled in large-scale software systems design, applications, and architecture, he's completed production work in several federal projects, including supporting FBI investigative capacities and the Library of Congress Congressional Record System. He's also the author of several books and essays on foundational ethics, ontology, and the philosophy of life. His website, magic-flight.com. Forrest, thank you so much for joining us on The Science of Magic.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Do you think we're in the middle of a shift in reality?
I think reality is shifting all the time, and it's quite a ride. It's fun to enjoy and to be alive.
It seems to be exhilarating during these days. What's causing this shift?
Well, I don't necessarily know that I could speak to causality at the level of what's happening in politics or in the world today, other than to say that the things that we all know, major changes in the climate, major changes in the economy, new ideas being brought forward, new technologies being brought forward, all of these things influencing people and civilization in multiple ways. As I was saying before, we live in interesting times, and we should, of course, learn as best as we can how to basically be in that context.
So here's an interesting one. What is wisdom?
Wisdom, I think, is a capacity to integrate, our experiences in our life and to be able to respond in a holistic way to the situations that we find ourselves in. So, there's a kind of maturity element which has to do with, how we respond to situations, our level of responsibility, and then really we want to take that to sort of a level of inclusiveness. So in other words, not just responding to our own needs or being responsible just for ourselves, but also being responsible to the environment, looking at the larger context of choices that people are making and trying to essentially, I guess you could say that there's an element of enablement in the process of wisdom. It's sort of responding from a deeper perspective.
My shamanic teacher taught me to always try to consider the best that serves all concerned, and that's all of our relations, including plants and animals. Is this kind of part of what you're talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that the Native American thing of thinking about the next seven generations is absolutely vital to having a really good, solid perspective. When we're making choices, if we're just thinking about the short term, we're not going to make as good choices as if we sort of think about the larger context, what's truly win-win for all people involved at all levels of being. So in other words, it's not that we have to make a choice that's either or. We basically want to make choices that are both and.
Yeah, we're going to have to take a short break. Forrest and I will return shortly, so don't go away. You're listening to The Science of Magic. Our current episodes are aired daily on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, xzbn.net. Prior innovative episodes can be accessed free of charge on our website, thescienceofmagic.net. The Science of Magic is produced by rel-mar McConnell Media Company, Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. The scientist and the mystic have been on an age-old, relentless search with one thing in common. They seek truth. Their paths converge in the 40,000-year-old practice of shamanism, an ancient science delving to the quantum level of life, facilitating healing, manifestation, and evolution. I'm Gwilda Wiyaka, the founder and director of Path Home Shamanic Arts School, a unique Colorado State-certified occupational school training shamanic practitioners and teachers. We also provide classes for empowering personal lives through shamanism. Our certification classes are in week-long segments, enabling international participation, and online classes and long-distance shamanic healing sessions are available. Come discover the science of magic in the limitless world of shamanism. www.findyourpathhome.com. Back, folks. This is The Science of Magic, dedicated to unification and evolution of consciousness. I'm your host, Gwilda Wiyaka. Our guest this hour is Forrest Landry, an author, philosopher, researcher, scientist, software developer, engineer, and craftsman. His website, magic-flight.com. Forrest, we were talking about the importance of considering the seventh generation, of considering all concerned in our decision-making coming from wisdom. And it seems like we've been living in a very short-sighted period, haven't we?
I would think so, yeah. There's a tendency for people to think in terms of optimizing. So they want to, optimize the number of people that are clicking on their website, or they want to optimize the number of sales or the number of voters and things like that. Whereas really we live in a world that is more about the kinds of relationships that we have. We constantly ask each other what's important, what is the most meaningful thing. And that sort of focus about looking at the deeper meanings, looking at the deeper connections and the relationships and the kind of values that we fulfill with each other is something that we need to practice and get better at, because that's a lot of what makes life a lot more enjoyable. It also makes it a lot healthier, because when we think about the future and we think about the possibilities, we can, in a sense, look at reality in a more inclusive way.
It seems like we've been, again, short-sighted, but also we're not seeing the whole very well. Why do you suppose that is?
Well, I think that, as you mentioned earlier, it's a question of wisdom and a question of maturity. When people first come into this world, they're still learning how to live their own lives and how to have essentially their situation worked out. But as we get older, we start thinking in terms of other people, in terms of our immediate lovers, and then maybe with time in terms of a family, and then as you grow older, a larger family. Really, we're looking at kind of an accelerated process that allows us to think in terms of broader and broader context. So you go from the family to the community, and then from the community to essentially the environment and to larger issues. What we're really looking to do is to have that happen sooner and more fully, because the kinds of issues that are facing humanity today environmental problems and things like that, really require a much higher level of responsiveness on our part in order to be able to adequately address. So while people may have, they get maturity as they develop through life and such like that, assuming things go well, we're needing to have more emphasis on that. I think a lot of the advertising and a lot of the marketplace and such like that, cell phones and Twitter and things like that, all encourage very short responses, very, very immediate responses, and our attention hasn't really been drawn into the larger context as fully.
Mm. You know, we seem to be moving from a polarized view where the thing is either is or it isn't. Is wisdom evolving as a result?
I think so. I mean, you know, part of wisdom is a perspective. You know, when we have a larger perspective, when we look things from a more holistic perspective, we see possibilities that otherwise might not have been available. And that's a big piece of it. Part of the benefit of having a larger perspective is seeing those options, those hidden paths. If you're presented with two choices, you might remember that actually you have an even bigger choice or a larger choice. Someone may ask you, well, do you want to buy the red car or the blue one? And it's our task to remember, well, maybe now is not the time to buy a car. Maybe I want to buy a bicycle, or maybe I basically want to fly on an airplane and travel that way. And so it's incumbent upon us to remember the larger context of the choices that we have and not to let ourselves get boxed in with the options that are being presented to us.
How about creating options? Do we have the option right now to start creating new options?
I do think so, yes. In fact, I think that's when we talk about the fundamental structure of reality, one of the things that I've basically been working with is not only can we create options, but that it's necessary and ethical for us to do so. In a lot of ways, there's these really low-level ideas that basically say, when presented with a choice, that it's always possible to choose in a win-win manner, and that the way that we make that happen or the way that we can bring that about is by creating new options. We can create intellectual models that sort of hem us in and things like that, but that really the effort here is to think of it in sort of a kind of design modality. How do I design a good choice? How do I design a choice that opens up future possibilities and future choices? So when we're making a choice, we're wanting to look at, you know, actualizing in the present, you know, the best possible outcome, win-win for all people involved. But we also want that choice to lead to future choices, lead to future opportunities, which are also enabling for all of the participants. And that's a practice. I mean, it's an ongoing effort. It's an ongoing consciousness. But it really carries a lot of rewards because you begin to see options, you begin to see possibilities, and to manifest them. And it's a very magical thing to do that.
Don't you think that it's a process of also rewiring the brain, because we have these neurological pathways burnt based on our agreed upon reality, which is polarized, dog eat dog. So aren't we actually having to rewire the way our brain works?
Well, in the same way that we would be redeveloping habits. So yes, in the same way that our neurology is an abbreviation of our perception. So in other words, we're not overwhelmed by our experiences. You know, habits are an abbreviation of our choices, so that we, in a sense, can focus on the things that matter. It's not that all habits are bad or that all neurology is bad. Obviously, there are some things about ourselves that are very well adapted to the world. But for the parts of us that don't fit or the things that aren't working, we need to be able to step back, look at the habits, make them into things that are choices, and then choose differently. And that takes effort. I mean, it's not overnight that a person changes a habit. When we're reworking our neurology and such like that, it's usually a consistent effort of about 40 days for the new habit to take effect.
Yeah, I call them subroutines. So like you have to dismantle one subroutine. You have to first become conscious of them, right? And then dismantle the ones that are no longer serving and choose which ones to build, so you still have a structure to come from.
Exactly. And that whole process is very worthwhile. I mean, first of all, it gives us the option of replacing non-working subroutines with working ones. And when we do that, we want to think about the kinds of things that the old subroutine was functional for. I mean, sometimes we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We want to say, okay, well, what were the needs that this was serving, and how can we meet those needs and also all these other needs at the same time and in a better way? So, you know, it's not that we're trying to, you know, wholesale just reject beliefs or habits or neurological patterns. We're basically trying to be conscious of how do we do good design? How do we create a method of interaction that is not only healthy for us, but healthy for the environment? And there's no reason why we can't get both of those objectives at the same time.
Forrest, what is ontology?
It's actually ontology. And it's
ontology.
Basically it's the study of the nature of being. So in other words, metaphysics in sort of the research or academic way is classically thought of as asking two really big questions. What is real and how do we know? The what is real question is what we mean by ontology. And the how do we know is known by the term of epistemology. And between those two topics, we're really considering the essence of what metaphysics is about, at least as far as a research philosopher would think about it. I tend to sort of expand on that notion a little bit to say that the real essence of the inquiry is the relationship between the self and the reality that one lives in, or between the subjective and the objective. And that really what we're looking at is an inquiry into the fundamental nature, the basic pattern that is intrinsic to the relationship between self and reality, subjective and objective. And that by understanding that, we can understand things like the scientific method, we can understand about choice, about causality, and a whole host of other things.
So it seems like the question itself that ontology brings up is that process that you were talking about, is re-examining, re-evaluating, reconsidering in order to let reality evolve. Is that true?
Yes, well, there's sort of a co-evolution between self and reality. I mean, if reality is changing, self needs to evolve in order to stay in balance with reality. And if self is changing, to some extent, you want to have your environmental circumstances continue to be, in balance with you. And that really there's a kind of reciprocity between those two aspects of it. But the real essence of what is interesting about that relationship is the relationship itself. In the same way that when we're working on a relationship with another person, a lot of it has to do with the communication. How good is the communication? Do people understand one another? Is there relatedness going on? And, through that process of thinking about the dynamic of the communication between self and reality, we can begin to make that communication cleaner, clearer, more fulfilling, more healthy, more sound in an ecological context. And that clarity is actually really enabling. It helps us to see options, make better choices, and to essentially create conscious, sustainable evolution, which is something to strive for in a large way.
So you're talking about the relationship between ourself and our personal reality, and also the relationship between ourself and everything else out there?
Yes. So in effect, you could think of it as, okay, everything outside of the surface of my skin I can think of as the world, and everything inside I can think of myself. But the position at which we put the relationship between self and reality is actually something of a variable. I mean, we can move the notion of self and have it be more inclusive or less inclusive depending upon what makes sense for the kind of context that we're thinking in, or the choices that we're making. Some of this gets kind of abstract pretty quickly, but the main thing that we're really looking at is, if I want to change a habit, I have to first identify it as a habit in order to make it something that I can be conscious of choosing. Whereas if the habit is something that I'm perceiving through, then it doesn't really look like anything I can choose. It's sort of the context of choice. A good example maybe to think about to sort of clarify this is that for many people who have a driver's license, when they first learn how to drive a car, their experiences of the steering wheel, of the pedals, of essentially the immediate automobile itself. But as we get more adapted to that experience and that environment, eventually we don't drive with the vehicle, we drive through the vehicle. In other words, the car becomes an expression of our relationship to the road or to other drivers or to essentially, some goal I want to get from here to there. And so we're not really thinking of the car as something we interact with, but something we interact through. And that transition from, being in relationship with to being in relationship through is, in a sense, treating the automobile as an extension of ourselves. And that would be a case in which the boundary of self has actually moved.
That sounds
again,
like a pretty healthy movement.
It does. And so, to some extent, if we were having bad driving habits, we'd have to, in a sense, reverse that flow. We'd have to, in a sense, remember that oh, this is something that I'm relating with and therefore be able to change my relationship with. So, you know, in a lot of ways, we want to move the context around. We want, in a sense, see from multiple perspectives. You mentioned multidimensionality before. So where does dimensionality come from? Well, we have two eyes, right? When I'm talking the physical, you know, eyeball organ, right? And when we see from both of those perspectives, that we combine this each two-dimensional image to create a sense of depth, a sense of parallax, or essentially being able to tell how far away something is. And in the same way, when we're talking about perspective from one person communicating with another person, if I can see from someone else's point of view and integrate that with my own perceptions, then I perceive reality in a deeper way with more dimensions. So in a lot of ways, it's actually quite interesting to have conversations with people where you can gain.
I'm going to have to pick up on the other side with this subject, and I do want to do that. It's great. Forrest and I will return to our discussion on the other side of this break. So don't you go away. We're coming to you through the X-Zone Broadcast Network. Don't miss the other fine shows and hosts on xzbn.net. You're listening to The Science of Magic, thescienceofmagic.net. I'm Gwilda Wiyaka. Did you know that shamanism has been around for 50,000 years and practiced by all indigenous cultures? These ancients understood there's more to healing and health than just the physical. All four levels, physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual, must be addressed in order for us to enjoy healthy, abundant lives. To find quality shamanic healing you can trust, you need look no further than Path Home Long Distance Shamanic Healing Program. All Path Home practitioners have been trained and certified through Path Home Shamanic Art School, a Colorado State occupational school, and are handpicked, personally trained by me, Gwilda Wiyaka, to uphold the excellence of Path Home's long-distance program. Live abundantly. Schedule a shamanic session with me or one of my quality practitioners today. Call 303-775-3431 or visit findyourpathhome.com. Welcome back. This is The Science of Magic, a place where magic and science come together to promote enlightenment. I'm your host, Gwilda Wiyaka. This hour, our guest is author Forrest Landry. His website, magic-flight.com. Forrest, we were talking about how you get binocular vision, if you will. You get depth perception because you have two eyes. There's a concept called triangulation, where you look at things from three different viewpoints. When and how does that fit in here?
Well, it does. I mean, it's basically, the combining of multiple viewpoints creates an increasing depth. So the more viewpoints that we can bring together, you know, more than just two, the greater level of dimensionality and depth that is available. Every single pairing between, two different viewpoints contributes another dimension. And so if I have three viewpoints, then I have essentially three new dimensions because there's three pairs. If I add four viewpoints, then I get even more possible pairings, and so the level of dimensionality increases geometrically in proportion to the number of combined viewpoints. And really, there is a kind of sensitivity. I mean, we want to have those viewpoints well combined. In other words, there's a sense of allowing another person's point of view to be truly authentically theirs, and really being honest and understanding your own viewpoint, having a good sense of knowledge of self. And then being able to synthesize or to bring together those multiple viewpoints in a way that creates coherency, creates a kind of perspective that is inclusive of those.
And this is
a very powerful technique.
Isn't that what you're doing by combining all these different things that you're in? You know, from philosophy to ontology. Isn't that part of what you're doing as well?
Yes, I enjoy many different aspects of life, and being able to think about things from a craftsman point of view, from a sort of information science point of view, from a very theoretical point of view in terms of mathematics or physics, from a philosophical point of view, from a kind of human nature and emotional point of view, you know, all of these are very, very different ways of looking at each situation. And by basically having facility with each of these languages, each of these modes of relationship, we, in a sense, gain a level of facility in the sense that we can say, okay, well, this problem might not be easy to solve in this language, but I know how to translate it into this other language where it really is easy to work with. And I solve it there, and then I can translate the answer back into the first language that I was working in. And this technique is it's a known technique. I mean, I didn't invent that, but people have been doing things like that for a long time. So by having a lot of languages, you basically have a toolkit that allows you to interact with great facility with new situations and with new questions that come up. That gives you a lot of creative capacities.
So when we're bringing all these different viewpoints together, what's the value of bringing all the practices together at this particular time?
Well, especially for the situation that we're in the world today, I mean, there's a lot of problems that humanity is facing, and they're not going to be solved using the tools and technology that created the problems in the first place. We're, in effect, going to have to design new solutions, come up with new ways of thinking about it. And so, in effect, the practices is one that is, you know, really needing to be sustaining and nurturing of life. You know, anything that doesn't sustain or nurture life is not going to continue to live. So, you know, just from a very practical, very pragmatic point of view, it's really incumbent upon us to recognize that in our, you know, technology and in our capacities that we have, we have in effect become like gods in this world. We have a level of responsibility with all of these technologies and powers that we have, in a sense, encumbered ourselves with. And so, in effect, we need to be more responsible. We need to be more conscious of the impact of what we're doing. We need to think longer about, you know, the kinds of choices we're making and the kind of impacts they're going to have, and think of what kinds of choices can we make today that will facilitate a more graceful future. My partner basically says, be kind to your future self. And, you know, in the sense, in a larger context, not only do we need to do that individually, but we as a planet, as a species, need to be kind to our future self.
Absolutely, we do. What is research metaphysics?
So basically, the whole idea is, as I mentioned earlier, is essentially an inquiry into the relationship between self and reality. So on one level, we're looking at it from a theoretical point of view, but on another level, we're looking at it a very practical point of view. So we're trying to understand what are the essential nature of the relationship between self and reality, and things we find out. Like, for example, in the English language, we tend to take the word existence to be real and to be objective as if they were synonymous. But as we investigate, we discover that these terms are actually used in different ways, and that there's really a distinction between them, and that the notion of to be real is actually, in a certain sense, more primal than the notion of to exist or to be objective. And you say, well, okay, that's maybe a technical thing, but what it does is that clarity allows us to ask different questions. So in effect, we move to the level of thinking about choice, change, and causality as the foundation of the real. And then we can start thinking about things like, well, what is the relationship between choice and determinism, as it comes up in philosophical foundations of science thinking. And, you know, if we investigate that, we can say, well, we notice that there is a difference between the notion of causality and the notion of determinism, and that the world that we live in is actually a causal universe rather than a deterministic one. So even though our scientific methods are modeled, and mathematics is essentially presenting a model which is essentially structured and allows us to predict the future and so on and so forth, that there's an element of our experience, there's an element of our interaction with reality that is not predictable, that is not knowable in advance. And so, you know, we've explored that with quantum mechanics, and we've explored that with, you know, essentially sort of the kind of nonlinear, chaotic kind of phenomena such as weather and things like that. And so we're beginning to understand a little bit more about our relationship with reality in terms of time and the fundamental ideas that compose the very foundations of science. That whole area of investigation is what we mean by research metaphysics.
Okay. Could you speak to the relationship between physics, metaphysics, and philosophy?
So physics is essentially, there's three different kinds of questions. So physics is an answer to a why-type question. So we ask, well, you know, why does this happen or why does that happen? So you know, when we come up with models. So physics is essentially, you know, an answer to a why question. Metaphysics is actually asking a different question, and a somewhat deeper one. Its main question is what? So metaphysics isn't really about trying to answer why something happens. It's just trying to describe the nature of what these concepts are. So, for example, when we say, okay, something is real, or what do we mean by the notion of choice, or what do we mean by the notion of causality? It's not just a semantic exercise. It's more about the relationship between the concepts. So in a sense, what we're trying to do is we're trying to find out what are the deepest concepts that essentially underlie things like the scientific method or the notions of time and space and probability, and how do we understand the relationships between those concepts, and what do those relationships actually consist of? How clear can we make our understanding of those relationships? Philosophy, in contrast to metaphysics, is essentially asking actually somewhat broader questions. So, you know, traditionally philosophy would be just the study or the love of kind of the knowledge of, you know, how to live a good life and things like that. And it's usually regarded as consisting of topics like ethics, aesthetics, and ethics being, you know, what is a choice that's a good choice? And aesthetics would be, what is a choice that's a beautiful choice? So, you know, if we take a look at metaphysics, we're looking at, you know, what is reality and how do we know anything about reality? How do we know anything at all? Whereas when we go to philosophy, we're looking at a more practical human relationship kind of perspective of how do I personally live a good life? What is the nature by which I experience the world, and how do I integrate myself into it, and how do I integrate my experiences into myself? That gets more into the notions of spirituality.
Got it. So how do you view magic, and how would you define it?
So in a lot of ways, as an engineer, there's kind of this interesting reciprocity between magic and engineering. As an engineer, I'm trying to essentially constrain the possibilities to be just the thing I want to have happen. So when I'm writing software, I'm trying to prevent bad things from happening and make it so that only the good thing can happen. Whereas in a sort of magical way of thinking, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to create more possibilities. I'm trying to make it more likely that the good thing will happen by creating more more good things to choose from and having essentially opening up the door of more potentiality. So in one case, it's sort of like I'm trying to narrow focus in one direction. In another case, I'm trying to broaden focus and make it more attractive in that particular direction.
Aren't you
Go ahead.
Go ahead. I was going to ask, aren't you also working with, so if you're working with the engineering, you're working with the physical aspect, and when you're working with the magic, you're working before it becomes physical, like in the quantum level?
Well, in a sense, potentiality is not a physical thing. I mean, you know, we have actuality, you know, we have essentially the see and touch world that is essentially our immediate experience, but the potentials of the future, what could happen, what sort of things are possible. We are, in effect, engaged in an exercise of design. We're looking at opening up more possibilities. And I'm not just thinking about that in a technological way. I'm thinking about that also in emotional ways. You say, as you have greater wisdom and you perceive more possibilities, you have more dimensions and levels of engagement, more languages that you speak in terms of, you know, the skills and practices, you begin to see how to open up the door to more things to become possible. And to encourage those things, to sort of nurture them. Magic is not it's not something that we can compel. It's only something that we can encourage. And so in a lot of ways, you know, it's sort of like, you know, trying to create growth or try to create healing. You can't purchase those things at a drugstore. You have to, in a sense, nurture them into being by creating good, nurturing circumstances.
How much does our belief systems and our intent play into delving into magic?
I think it plays a lot of role. I mean, you know, when I think about the practice, I'm thinking about intent as essentially being the very first and most essential step. Well, actually, there's lots of essential steps, but the first aspect is to have clarity of intention. Mm-hmm. You want to be really specific about what it feels like to have a certain experience. I mean, you know, if we're looking about you know, relationships, for example, I need to, in a sense, have the clarity about the qualities of the person I want to come into relationship with, rather than say things like how tall they are and how much they might weigh or what their eye color might be, or you know, those kinds of attributes would actually be very limiting. Whereas if you're talking about qualities of experience and you become really, really clear about that, then in effect what you've done is you've allowed the form of how that experience may come into your life to essentially be open. It's sort of like you make a deal with the universe. You say, okay, I'm going to pick how it feels, and you can pick how it shows up. And the clearer you are about how it feels, the simpler it's going to be for it to show up.
So it's an act of envisioning what you want or designing it in the imagination. And I've heard that if you can't imagine it, you can't create it.
That's true. And the thing is that in effect, what we're looking is to have a clear feeling. So we're trying to imagine the experience as we receive it. And part of that, as you were saying, if you can't imagine it, it's that you can't see yourself receiving it. And so as a result, the effort becomes, how do I become the vehicle that can receive this experience? How do I transform myself so that I can in a sense recognize when the opportunity has arisen, when the circumstances
that the iron. We're going to have to take another little time out. Forrest and I will be back shortly, so don't leave us now. This is the Science of Magic, your resource to altruistic professionals of science and the esoteric, working to create common ground for the betterment of our world. Join our email family to receive our topic-driven episode collections at thescienceofmagic.net.
Gwilda Wiyaka's latest book, The Science of Magic, Book of Mysteries, Volume 1, is the first book in a series based on her writings that open every episode of the Science of Magic radio show. Drawing on the subject matter of each guest, and armed with over 40 years' experience in shamanism, 35 years in alternative health, and degrees in psychology and religious studies, Gwilda introduces relevant and leading-edge information that supports spiritual evolution and personal empowerment. Rich with wisdom and inspirational quotes packaged in digestible segments, this is a book that will pull you from cover to cover. It will also serve as a daily inspirational reading for years to come. The Science of Magic Book of Mysteries, Volume 1, is available at our website, tsompublications.com, amazon.com, and wherever fine books are sold.
Welcome back. This is the Science of Magic, bringing together gifted people of service to the world. I'm your host, Gwilda Wiyaka. What's up in your world? Email me at info@thescienceofmagic.net and suggest a topic that's on your mind. You're probably not the only one interested. Again, our guest this hour is Forrest Landry. His website, magic-flight.com. Forrest, we've been pondering very heady things for the first part of this program. Let's go into love. What can you tell me about love?
So basically, love is that which enables choice. And this is a very, 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 very specific practice. When we say we love another person, the highest meaning of that is to essentially say, I'm choosing in a way that enables your choices. I don't want to choose on behalf of you. I don't want to limit your choices. I want you to become the most complete, most alive, most creative and vibrant and fulfilled version of yourself that is possible. And in doing that, I get to know who you are. I get to know more of the creature that you are and that you can become. So when we say that we love another person, we're really talking about a very deep knowledge of ourselves and of them, and basically wanting to enable them to become more alive. So the notion of enabling choice is very, very fundamental to this idea. And there's a lot of different ramifications to that. So, for example, when we're talking about how a parent might love a child, we're looking at a situation where the parent knows that someday that child is going to become an adult, and that the best way that we can serve them, the best way that we can enable them to have a healthy and fulfilled life is to encourage wisdom in them, to encourage them to be aware of the choices and to make good choices. And we can't do that by making the choices for them. We can only do that by essentially nurturing their capacity to choose. And obviously this is a very gradual thing. You don't want to put too many choices in front of a person too quickly, but you want to basically do it in a way that is integrated with their current situation, with their current level of health and awareness, and that really when we're talking about enabling choice, we're really implementing the practice of love. And so this is a different way of thinking about it. It's not necessarily grounded in just how one feels or the emotions that one has or some sort of, you know, particularly poetic way of looking at it, but it's a very, very clear way of thinking about it. When I'm wondering whether or not someone's loving me, I can think about, you know, are they trying to limit who I am, or are they trying to enable who I am? And if I get the sense that it's an enabling thing, then I'm going to have the experience, I'm going to have the feeling of being loved. And the way that I create that in other people, like I said, is essentially to create choice, to create options, to create things which are nurturing to them and their well-being. And this scales to all sorts of levels. For instance, we could think about, you know, the relationship between, say, a government and the people. What is the function of government? What is it for? Well, ultimately, fundamentally, it's really about, you know, protecting the land and the people. And that if we have a really enlightened government, we're looking at something that is not just protecting them, it's actually helping them to thrive. It's helping, you know, people to live fulfilled lives. It's helping to create, you know, a sort of ecology that is preserving for future generations, and so that they can, in a sense, have fulfilled lives. You know, this notion of love is that which enables choice is truly a key touchstone as to what is the essential idea of what we mean by that term.
So if we get down more into the energetics of it, is love an emotion, or do we have an emotional response to its frequency?
I think of love as an emotion. So I've described it as a practice, but mm-hmm. I'm also, you know, saying that energetically it is an emotion. It's essentially a flow of energy. So in a lot of ways, we can think of it as kind of like this cloud of energy that is permeating all things, and that when we're basically trying to show love to another person, what we do is we tap into this field of potentialities, and we take some of the potentials that we experience, some of the energies that we experience there, and we focus it in the direction of another person. We bring it to a kind of a clarity to essentially enable another person. But it starts off as an emotional experience. Well, at least I'm saying that there's an energetic element to it. I mean, any time that we're expressing an energy, any time that we're making a choice, we're in a sense, you know, moving energy from the inside, from the subjective, into the outside world, into the objective. And so, in a lot of ways,
when we're letting love move through us into the world, loving others, loving our environment, what effect does that have on the world at large?
Well, the first thing I wanted to say is that to allow love to move through oneself, clarity is essential, right? The more that we can create clarity in ourselves, the more clean and pure and supportive our love actually is. When that clarity manifests in the world, it manifests as a kind of a light. It manifests as a kind of enablement. And so, as a sense, what happens is that the increased potentialities in the world lead to an actuality that is more fulfilling, because obviously that's the whole point. I mean, if we weren't loving very well, the world itself would not improve. It wouldn't necessarily become a better place. You know, it's kind of cliche as a manufacturer or as a business owner to say, hey, you know, I want to change the world. Whereas really what we're looking at is helping other people. We're looking at creating essentially lives that are easier, you know, more fulfilled, more alive, and of course that is making the world a better place. So, you know, it's not difficult to hypothesize that, you know, by thinking about sustaining conscious, conscious sustainable evolution, we're looking at essentially helping the world to be healthier.
Mm. Would you speak to the importance of the unity of heart and mind, particularly at this time?
So when we act as a whole self, the effectiveness that we have, the level of influence, the level of impact that we have in the world is greatly increased. So for instance, if we're acting as a whole being, heart, mind, and body, if we're in a sense all aligned, moving in the same direction, then that becomes a very powerful force, a very organized. The more coherent I am, the more that all of the aspects of my being are in alignment, the more that coherency leads to potentiality, leads to a kind of magical capacity to create more options. When the self is divided, when the heart's moving in one direction and the mind's moving in another and the council of being is essentially divided, one's effectiveness in the world is greatly diminished. It's not in proportion. It's like a logarithmic or an exponential effect. If I'm divided in half and you know, conflicted in my own sense, my effectiveness in the world is much less than half the influence. Whereas if I'm unified as a being, or better, if I'm in coherency with other people, and we're all together moving as a group, then the level of change that can be created, the level of potentiality that's available, is enormous, much, much greater than the sum of the parts.
So you see love as unifying, as the essence that unifies all things?
It allows us to come together in a coherent way. It allows us to, in a sense, be not only able to cooperate, but to have the maturity and the vision to see what sort of changes, what sort of things we want to encourage, what sort of things that are actually right, a win-win choice to make in the world. And, you know, that's really easy to get behind. I mean, you know, if we're talking about unconditional love, we have to, in a sense, enable unconditional acceptance. And that's a reciprocal process in ourselves as well as in other people.
Mm.
Obviously, if we create that kind of outcome, there's no question that people are going to be happier. On a philosophical level, all of this is very simple. When we're getting down to the actual practices of it, of course, you know, the real essence of it, like I said, is creating clarity. How do I become clear? And the more clear I am, the more that I can let the light through. I can in a sense let the openness happen.
Yeah, I have a saying: the light is only as clear as the window through which it shines. It's all about clarity, isn't it?
Exactly.
So what's next for you, Forrest? What do you believe your service is to the world?
Well, as you've probably noticed, I basically am trying to enable the world to be a better place, and my particular idea of that is to have my focus, I guess, the specific thing that I'm particularly passionate about, is the relationship between man and nature in terms of how we create health in the trees, particularly. My name is Forrest, so I have a particular reverence for trees. I have a particular reverence for the forest. And so a lot of what I'm interested in is, in a sense, creating healthier ecosystems. And that's been sort of the focus of why I've developed all this philosophy, why I think about these issues. And how I bring, you know, business practices together and all that.
So it's my head just opened up when you said that. Life works in a particular way, and it sounds to me like you're hooking into it on all levels, including in computers and in trees.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. I see a great unity between a very analog way of relating to the world and a very digital way of relating to the world. I have great depth of experience in both realms, the analog and the digital. And for me, the interesting questions are the relationships between the two. Looking at the organic, working with wood and so on and so forth, and at the same time understanding how, you know, people interact and how the ecosystem is essentially created around a product. And at the same time, you know, understanding things like computer science and looking at mathematics and technology and the kinds of ways in which those interact with humanity and nature as well. Fascinating series of questions in that space. I spend a lot of time thinking about the relationship between the organic and the inorganic.
And it goes back to multidimensionality, doesn't it?
It does indeed.
It does indeed. Forrest, I can't thank you enough for the beautiful service you're doing to the world. And you keep your hands on that wood. It seems to be giving you some good lessons there. Bless the trees, huh?
You're most welcome.
Bye-bye now. Our guest this hour has been Forrest Landry, an author, philosopher, researcher, scientist, software developer, engineer, and craftsman. His website, magic-flight.com. This has been The Science of Magic. Until next time, dear ones, may you find all you desire, want, and need as you live in the center of unconditional love.